first gift from Lester Bechtel, a churchman and a lover of ideas, and he offered to the Conrad Grebel University College a lectureship that would bring together the academy and the church and the community to explore topics related to Anabaptist and Mennonite faith, culture, heritage, and so on. Over the past 15 years, we've had an amazing series of lectures and conversations about Mennonite history in varied parts of the world, about peace and reconciliation, creative writing, numerous other topics that have enriched the life of the college and the community. And this is the 15th year of the Bechtel Lectures. And so I'd like to acknowledge the Bechtel family here tonight, Lester, and Debbie, and Cam, and Bruce. Thank you so much for this gift to the college. It's wonderful for us to have this lectureship, so thank you. Tonight, we'll be hearing about defiance, a nice balance from doubt, I think. And we have the opportunity this year to double up, as it were, our second Bechtel lecture with a Mennonite writing series that is underway this year. And to introduce that, and to introduce our Bechtel lecturer for this year, Dr. Jeff Gundy, I'll call upon the Dean of Conrad Grebel, Dr. Trevor Bechtel.
It's not exactly right. What I should have is a small Tibetan chime. If I were Jeff Gundy, that is how I would begin every class at Bluffton University. Good evening. We are very glad to have you here at Grebel tonight. I'd like to add my welcome to Marlene's. It's a real honor for me to be able to introduce my friend Jeff Gundy to you this evening, in this second evening of the Bechtel Lectures, and the second in our Mennonites writing series. Here at Grebel, we're very excited about this reappearance of a Mennonite writing series. At the end of October, Rudy Weeb was here. Tonight we have Jeff Gundy. And next will be Miriam Taves, whose All My Puny Sorrows is this year's Writers' Trust Fiction Award. So come back to hear her on November the 26th in our Great Hall. This series of readings and discussions has been planned and hosted by Rob Zacharias, who's over here. Rob is a Banting postdoctoral fellow based here at the University of Waterloo in the Department of English Language and Literature. He has a focus on Canadian literature with a special interest in Mennonite writing. And Rob will host a question and answer after tonight's lecture. So, by way of introduction, I want to tell you a few of the ways that I've encountered Jeff over the last 10 years. We've worked together for the last 10 years at Bluffton University. I knew him first as a mentor. One of my clearest teaching epiphanies came during a contract renewal session. I had been criticized by my students for not putting outlines up on the board for them to follow as I lectured. Jeff supported my more scattered approach. He suggested that I create more appropriate expectations for my students. "Trevor," he said, "whenever I begin a class with a new group of students, I tell them, the board is not for you to take notes from. The board is a workspace for my brain." I knew him next as a musician. Every fall, Jeff and his wife, Marlies, who's with us tonight, and his harmonica player, the American historian Perry Bush, would play and sing a number of classic cover songs for Bluffton's faculty follies. They have a sort of Blues Brothers-ish act working on. And it takes me no effort at all to conjure up Midnight Special, see the three of them moving and singing, with Jeff playing his guitar at the middle of it all. next as a poet. Jack has been a regular fixture at Mennonite writing conferences, the Sound in the Land conferences. I often have had the opportunity to hear him read his poetry as he has launched his last few books. The movement of his body as he encounters the words that he has written, this is also firmly etched in my memory. I am an amateur songwriter, and as a junior faculty member, I think that I asked Jeff a couple of times whether or not he ever thought of putting his words to music. He always said no. But a couple of years ago, with the publishing of, or before the publishing of his new book, the one that Jeff has recently released, Summer Year Defiance, I was delighted to realize that Jeff has now also taken to joining those of us amateur songwriters and is putting his words to music. And there's a CD that you can get along with this book that we'll probably need to talk to him about. So please join me in welcoming Jeff for what I am confident will be a very memorable book.
Standing up here talking, we're all just sitting out there listening, which is also realized, as I was thinking about this, that about the dearth of stories about boy Jesus, right? So not that I think nobody ever confused my son Ben with boy Jesus, I don't think, but I thought I would just, you know, momentarily sort of cross these things. So I wrote this poem called "How the Boy Jesus Resisted Taking Out the Trash." This is a poem. And he speaks. Oh, there's not enough to bother with. Oh, in a couple thousand years, the landfills will be groaning. Oh, we're too poor, there isn't any trash. Oh, what about Naomi? What does she do around here? Oh, if you ever suspected what's to come, you'd put me in the best chair and you'd kill the last goat for supper and feed me the hard and boil. Oh, not now. Oh, the members of my father's business and all that. Priests and Levites are going to love me. Some locusts will sing and sizzle. Precious stones will roll toward me like mice. Everybody's pretty daughters will cry because I don't like them that way. Oh, I'll change it into figs and honey later, all right? Oh, all right. As I said, that's probably a slightly more serious poem. From the same book, and this is also, as I recall, I dropped in off at a friend's and was driving back through the countryside, and the moon was coming up, it was the evening in the autumn, and it was really low and really red, and I had this, it was startling, and then I somehow connected that with this, watching something on TV late at night before, and come across this guy who was a theologian of some sort. And he was explaining the theory in this book that he just published about how God calibrates the suffering of each soul in hell. And that it's sort of, you know, sinners' desire to be tormented. And there was all that. There's this stuff. It's somewhat simple, so I won't say more about it. But somehow those two things crossed in my head. Views of the late rising moon. How is the sound? Can you hear me okay? Are you okay? The moon low and red, a fading coal fire. The inner provinces flinch and mutter at scenes of scrawny children, dirty shells, bare beds. Fortunately, we do not require their ardor. The moon a thumbprint in the slick clay. The trumpeter's swan collapsed at the quarry edge. Pale, oversized mystery among the common geese, swallowed buckshot burning inside. The moon too big, too hot, too hollow. The thin man explained the culmination of his years of study, that in his boundless love, God calibrates the agony of each poor soul in hell. The moon is smudge pot, an offering. Each sinner, he said, desires to be tormented. Each chooses eternal pain. The lean face shone with conviction. Our God, he said, only provides. The moon, a red doorway, a rip in the sky. I don't know who that guy was. I think I repressed. I'll be thinking about things to define. How many here? Had a kindergartner or a first grade teacher that you just really loved. Right. How many here had a kindergartner or first grade teacher that you really did not love at all? Okay. All right. Well, this is for you. This is called Ancient Themes, the First Teacher. An apple a day, keep the teacher away. That's what I learned. In those four tile days when lessons were hard, pine, and shrill, sit down, be still. You were tough and gnarly, Mrs. J. You knew what you wanted, and I wasn't even close. I was snippy, mean, too smart by half. You were right not to trust me. When the girls tittered and you snapped, I told Mom things were fine. That cafeteria day when you stretched your face at me, I knew I'd need luck and nerve to survive. At home, I flopped with the cat and Captain Jinx, searching for the secret. If I cleaned it all up before the grown-ups got home, years of intricate maneuvers, hundreds of lapses and blunders, finally I wasn't so tiny. Yes, this is personal, hard as the pine tables of that long-gone basement room where you broke every chunk of my soul you could reach. I kept most of the pieces. They went back together. It's time you got out of my head. All those years you lay cramped in the smelly restaurant, I passed by and saw your name and never once stopped. Even in that town where God's middle name is Listen, the buzz-cut boys are safe now. When I wake in a panic, I remember you didn't get me. You'll never touch my children. That was a satisfying. It's not really true that I passed by your door many times. I only went by it once, right in my book. I did not know what I would have said. It's possible, of course, that she wasn't as evil as she looms in my imagination. I was young back then. But it's also possible she was that evil. In this book, Deerflies, none of these poems were written about the time shortly after 9/11 and all of that stuff was going on. And the first time I traveled through an airport after that, you know, I was struck by how different things seemed. I wrote this poem, and Geraldo Rivera was on the TV, and what else was going on? Too many things I don't think. I just called in the air. The war on error? Is that it? All is war on the network. But Geraldo is anxious. It's not going well with the settlers. He says maybe it's time to pay attention to whatever the hell planet is. The retired Vietnam vet wants to be optimistic about the body count, but has learned his lesson, or some lesson. I've been wanted twice today, asked to take off my shoes, had my bag unpacked by a fairly cheerful guy who shrugged. Luck of the draw, he said. I'm fine. We're all fine. A garden should be one's individual paradise, says a voice with no body. Do not carry baggage belonging to others, says another. We are strong in war. The caves are no refuge. We mean no harm except to those who resist. Our girls have never been more beautiful, more wanton, more chaste. Our enemies will be torn to shreds, their blood will stain the snow, their women wail as their pathetic souls sink into hell. Peace will come. Peace is here. The Emperor is your friend. Please step over here, empty your pockets, and remove your shoes. And there's a little echo of Mark Twain's War Prayer in there. Do people know that? Imagine the voice of a chaplain pleads for God in his mercy to rend the enemy to shreds and set their women weeping barefoot through the snow and all this terrible stuff. It says at the end something like, and afterwards they thought the man was crazy because no one could understand what he said. You can find it on the web. I'm sure you all could read it after this. it's a terrifyingly beautiful piece of its kind. Not at all, when you come to think about associated with Mark Twain. Or in this sort of somber, you know, I'll read one more kind of somber poem. I was writing a lot of poems for a while. Driving in the car. For a brief period, I tried doing that, you know, with a little notebook and writing things down while I was driving. And I quickly realized that that was going to be suicidal fast. So I got a little tape recorder. This was, of course, in the days before cell phones. And now if you have a cell phone, you're talking to. So I took, you could all do this. You could choose, you know. But I would be driving along and start thinking about something. And often I was listening to music on the radio. And just talk into the describe it and see if I can get a poem out of it. And this was one of those. I was driving in Pennsylvania, and it's called Late Song, and it has an epigraph from 1 Samuel. Then David ran, stood over the Philistine, and took his sword, and drew it out of his sheath, and killed him, cut off his head. Passage, right? This has been preached on in church. It was dark when I left town, and still dark when day had come. The sky and trees dull and damp. I remembered the preacher. Consider David and Goliath, he said, the two of them boasting of their strength and the God who loved them, both of them warning that the other's sweet body must fall bloody in the dust and be torn by dogs. The children came up to hear the story told from them. I drove through scant snow and a long spectacle of tree after tree after tree, each brown and gray, its winter simplicity, singular, alone and not alone. Then the big old church, like another easy grove. Couldn't we name all the churches after trees and creeks? I wanted some sunshine, but that didn't mean I would get it. I wanted some words as clear and sharp as swords instead of a sword. Flurries and sunshine breaking through, suddenly the word sublime was in my head. I let a truck in ahead of me, past another, headed down the long, curving hill. And Jackson Brown sang, he rescued truth from beauty and meaning from belief. And the snowflakes seemed sparse enough to count, though I soon gave up. There are many worlds, and they are all in this world, held apart by thin braces of time and weather. Sometimes you can spray all you want and let the wipers run, but the windshield just won't come clean. Besides forgiveness, there must be something else, something like abandon, going on without forgetting, without fear. Abandon like the site of an ambush or the last camp on the way to the ambush, or the place where a few hungry people stayed afterwards. No fire, no water, just a place to lie down and snow. Okay, it's time for something a little less scary. I had this exercise that I like to do with students in my poetry classes, and it involves, you take two people, and you pick any two people, one of them a historical figure who's dead, and another who's alive now, and you put them in the same room and have some kind of conversation, have them talk to each other for a while. So I give this student this exercise to my poetry class, and we're going to write class for a little while. And I had this notion suddenly, when Madonna met Menno. this was long ago. Madonna was still sort of hit. This is a while back. I know she's somewhere else by now. So I had that thought, and the first line immediately came into my mind, which is still my favorite line of the poem. And then the rest just kind of unfolded from that. There was also the other specification was that there were a bunch of words in the poem, a bunch of words on this list that students were supposed to use as many of these words as possible. So there were words like river and needle, I think. Some of them, if you think there are words unexpectedly turning up here, some of these are on the list. So here it is. When Madonna met Ben, you're a slut, he said, but God loves you anyway. She took a long pull on her beard. Don't be simple, she said. I was a Catholic schoolgirl. I've known that since I was 12. She was all knees and ankles, and he was a river toad. The two of them crammed into a tiny booth among the hard drinking. Besides, I've got babies now, she said, and all that horror stuff was for sales anyway. I know what you mean, said Minnow. Most of my whoring was for the church, but I think I gave it up too soon. He took an even longer pull on his beard. I did a lot of brooding about the Blessed Mary back then, he said. I decided that Jesus slid out of her like a seed through a tube. She was just a vase for the beautiful flower. What a load, said Minnow. Mary was Jesus, and he was her too. Yeah, I've been wrong before, said Mel. the same themes and ideas and so forth kind of enter into to both of them. And so last night I wrote a poem which kind of meditates on some ideas from the theologian John Caputo. And another theologian that I read in the course of working on this project was a woman named Grace Jansen, who was a Mormon MB from Saskatchewan or somewhere in Western Canada. Is that right? Yeah. And I eventually moved to England, became a Quaker. I was a really fascinating writer, died unfortunately young before she really kind of completed her work. She was working on this series of books, very interesting books. And the epigraph to this poem is from a book of hers called Violence to Eternity, in which, among other things, she talks about the Old Testament, especially those first books of the Old Testament and Yahweh as he shows up there. And she's not a big fan of the God of the Old Testament, in the way that he operates in the world, at least as those stories are told. And so here's just one little quote to kind of encapsulate. The covenant, she says, is structured in violence and steeped in blood, from the blood of circumcision and endless animal slaughter, the brutal extermination of the people of the land, the Canaanites. So this poem is called Meditation with Muddy Woods and Swinging Bridge. Nature preserve. Just outside of Bluffton, Swinging Bridge. Hot wind from the west, trail still soft after a whole week's drying. Deer tracks, coon, one stubborn mud hiker's deep scours, each like a little boat with a long, wet nest. Wood piled everywhere, neat rows for wood stoves, heaps of trash and branches. We were in Salzburg when a great storm scattered the old trees on the Kapuziner Berg like pickup sticks. Today, I brought nothing but pins, keys, notebook, comb, bicycle, lock, wallet, and credit cards. And these, a big black fly seems to like, and shorts with a pocket ripped 2 summers ago, still not fixed. My morning reading. What kind of God would drown every living thing that wouldn't fit on some puny ark? Would slaughter the people of Canaan for the sake of one hungry band of nomads? Any good gravel paths lead from the subdivision into the woods, but only the animals use them. Somebody's cutting something hard in a dry swimming pool. Who discovered we could cast our anger at the sky and get it back named God? In my old house, the bathroom sink plugs up every 4 months. I know exactly how to swear and clear it. Small white blooms all over the multi-floor rows, bushes twice my size. Seed pods float in the pond like mothers determined to tan whether or not their children get lost in the bushes. On a day this hot and green, it seems crazy to think that God picks signs. One plank of the swinging bridge is missing, one bowed and soft, and a big lost branch is wedged high between the end posts, but I walk across it anyway. So I think you can sense there are a certain degree of defiance of a certain kind of narrative, the kind of narrative that says that we have God on our side, we can kill whoever we want, and a blessing triumph. I mean, that, of course, has been popular narrative. All over the place. So it takes a good deal to resist that. I want to read a couple of was a damp sort of experience, but still pretty wonderful. And so these poems, there are seven of these little contemplations in here. There's a lot of moisture in all of them. I'll just read you a couple of them. This one's called Contemplation with Rain and Birdsong. When it stops raining, the loons will barely notice. When it stops raining, I'll push down my hood. When the rain stops, maybe I'll remember that the fight in the heart is not to complain unless it's really someone's fault. To notice the line made by the water dripping from the road that holds up the tarp and keeps us sort of dry. The rain will stop and we'll wish it would rain. It will rain again when we don't want rain. Then I'll walk with my sweetie, and just as I am thinking how beautiful she is, she will complain about her hair frizzing everywhere, and I will say that it falls around her face like an angel's. When it rains, the little camp bird will come out unhappy, search among the roots and stones, and the white-throated sparrow, whose song is common as air in those trees, will sing it like it's never been heard before, and will be lost forever when he lets it. The white-throated sparrow, people know this bird it sings the same song over and over and over again. And the director of the group, Lourdes Wins, that was with us on this trip, and she said these birds drive her absolutely crazy. All summer, they sing the same song over and over and over and over again. It's like 8 or 9 notes. It's kind of charming the first 100 times that you hear it. After a while, she said it will have one thing. I didn't get asked on it, but that was over there. One more of these. This is called Contemplation on Rules and Lines. It's got William Lake in it. And he said, he wrote this wonderful piece called The Marriage of Heaven and Hell. And in this, there are a bunch of devilish maxims. Yeah? In this poem, the devils are the representations of energy. And heaven is the place of reason, and hell is the place of energy. And Blake's theory was that these two were the kind of contraries that needed to be held in balance rather than choosing one or the other. So there are all these maxims in there, and the poem starts with one of them. One law for lion and ox is oppression. But of which one? That's my question. The ghost of William Blake, gnarled and smiling in the hollow between tree and stone, refuses to say. One law for water and rock is precision. Whenever they meet, water does all the talking. Another law is rubbing. Another can be spoken clearly only in moon. Another takes 300 earth years to state. A lost fish line dangles like a strand of golden thread, left behind by a traveler who went back home with nothing but bug bites and a solid case of John Hitch. I'm not so careful myself, but I wish I were, and I tell myself that counts for something. The wind's law is this: be yourself, and I will show you what that is. The water's law is this: tell me anything, only my face will answer. I will hold the little ones in their little boats. I will let them go when they choose, if they have the strength. I will tell them what they must know, even if it breaks their backs or their hearts. I will tell them what they want to know, only if they ask very softly and more. So I have also been lucky enough to spend some time, a number of time, weekends at a sort of writer's retreat on Kelly's Island, which is out in Lake Erie, just 2 or 3 hours from Bluffton. And a group of us that gather there usually every fall and rent this big house, sit around for a few days, read each other's work, gossip, talk. It's a great time. There's trails to walk around there. them are fiction writers, and most of them are women. So I always feel just a little bit on the edge of the group, although we're all good friends. And so this is a poem that sort of comes out of one of those, the first night of the year one here. And it has an epigraph from the great Swedish poet Thomas Tranströmer, and I brought his book along that time. And the quote is this: "Each man is a half-open door leading to a room for everyone." And the poem is called "Evening with Longinus." My friends say Tolstoy really got into the heads of his female characters. They give him credit. They talk dreamily of the books they love, books so long only two would make a whole course. This seems to me like making 12 gallons of chili and eating nothing else till it's gone. But I smile and listen. My friends are smarter than me and more patient, surely. I'm the only guy in the house tonight, so I get my own room with a good foam mattress, a bad desk, windows that open on other rooms. I make up the bed and lie down with Tranströmer's poems, 10 or 20 lines on a page, fewer words in 50 years than Tolstoy or George Eliot put down in a decent room. Each man is a half-open door. The door to my room is cracked open, lights blaze outside, my friends are all upstairs. If I don't shut the light off, no one. The wind will settle toward morning. The waves begin again to spell their single complicated word. Waiting for the ferry, we watch the hawk try to lift the 4-foot snake from the shallows. Drop it, circle, swoop, and grab again and lose its grip and veer away. Oh, how sweet would that meat have been? How grand a feast. How we would have cracked and sucked the bones. How long we could have made that story. So I think I will read two or three more poems, and then we'll have a little time for questions and so forth. Somebody mentioned this poem today, speaking about varieties of defiance. I discovered a long time ago that one of the ways I could survive faculty meetings and other such gatherings was to get out my notebook and my pen and just start writing things down. And generally, people would assume that, I was paying attention and that I was being a good citizen and really trying to further the work of the community and all those good things. Sometimes I was. But the thing you can do, I recommend this to all of you, really, whenever you're in meetings that are large enough that nobody can actually see what you're writing down, and when you reach that point when Maybe nobody even reaches this point in meetings where you have a sense that you could just explode if you just sat there, or just die. I don't think everybody's ever actually died at a meeting on a meeting. But anyway, I'm in this habit, and I've written a number of poems sort of out of these faculty meeting things, but this is a fairly recent one. Notes from the faculty. After 8 years of bounty, the cow has dried up. Behind the great man, the shield icon pulsed, patient as a heart. Like seeds, some ideas appear whole and undamaged, but will never sprout. Any form of motion draws the eye. So far, every page of this yellow pad is torn ragged. This troubles me more than it should. I vowed to hold my breath until I heard a things count? Students? Projections? My attempt at narrative, jumbled already, was interrupted by the need to apply. The phrase difficult challenge was not followed by showers of gold. Forming a task force did not lead to pursue the great one. Most students believe they're more honest than most students. After a national search, we hired Randy's brother. That really did happen. And I have to say, I should explain, it really was a good decision. So now, these two guys have offices next to each other. They're entirely different. They're both rural, young scholars, but wildly different. It's wonderful to have both of them. All right, I want to read another poem about, a certain kind of privilege and how God sort of deals with that, I guess. A number of years back, I think it was 2006 or so, my in-laws who live in Vancouver sold their house and moved into a condo and had some extra money, and my brother-in-law convinced them to spend some of it taking us all on a cruise to Alaska, right? And I don't know how y'all feel about cruises. How many people here have been on a cruise? Fess up. Okay, all right, lots of us have. Okay, well, I'd always thought that these were, the ultimate expression of bourgeois terribleness, to be avoided at all costs. But I could hardly not go, and I decided I was going to be a good sport about it. And of course, they feed you like mad. And it was Alaska, which is absolutely gorgeous. So I actually discovered I had a really good time. It seemed kind of, I felt guilty about that. But I also discovered that on this vast cruise ship, if I wanted to, almost any time of day, I could walk around the ship for 10 minutes or so, find some place where there's hardly anyone. And so I could sit, look out, watch the scenery go by, and kind of write things in my own book. So this is called Passage. Comes out of that. On the swift cruise, there was only time and water, twin mothers of an anxious son, and money. In the long end of day, we pushed right at the sun and failed again except to witness the beauty softened by mist and latitude until we could almost bear it. What else could we do? We could drain the tanks in a long, stern chase and never get closer. Two-footed, chilled, awkward as we are, the vast ship tiny on the sea. When the captain spoke, we couldn't understand. When the cruise director spoke, we didn't listen. There was free champagne, but we didn't get any. If there were stars, we missed them. On the sea, only the surface matters anyway. The white caps, a fresh sign of the spirit, heavy in the cold surge, foaming toward the full north, sliding calm as paradise away as we watched for a tail, a spout, some sign from underneath. So the wake curled endlessly, the radars whirled, meals were heaped and spread all day, and the servants pretended to love the work. The fog had its charms, and the chill breeze too, and we learned that the coast range and the island range allow anyone passage. They were parents, aging gently, good providers with little to say. Then there were long books written in the old tongue, the one God made up before she had company. Then there were houses for any spirit brave enough to make the journey. Then the fog was laughter, was music, was long hair combed out damp at the fire. And we walked the slick deck in the long dusk, and the ship bore us north, and in the dawn the mountains were tattered sails at the fringes of memory, and the summer home God built when all our speaking was too much, and the tousled hair of a quiet daughter, a face too sweet to bear, except in film. Thank you all again for being here, and I would close by reading the title poem from this book, and I'll tell you a little bit about it. For a long time, I've been thinking about, and one of the essays in the Songs from the Cage book is about peace poetry, and there was sort of there's been a criticism of Mennonite poets in recent years for not writing enough peace poems, so my argument in the essay that I wrote in response to that was that it seemed to me like poets that I knew were writing a lot about peace. If you understand that in our time, we're so far from the wars that are going on, that what peace means and what it means to sort of
guess what? I've just discovered that war is bad. Yeah. Now that you know this, do something about it, right? I mean, you know, yeah, where does that go? So, at the same time, I wanted to try to figure out how I might sort of enter into this conversation. And so, this poem sort of took shape over a long time. It took forever to kind of get this into shape. And oddly, we're talking about this in dinner a little bit, there's a sung version of this, and I finished the song before I finished the poem. And kind of go back and forth between them. So anyhow, this is the poem, Defiance, which is this town nearby where I live now, northern Ohio, northwest Ohio. Before it was just Defiance was the site of Fort Defiance, and it was the site of a battle during the Indian Wars in that area. General Anthony Wayne, who Fort Wayne is named after, he's also known sometimes as Bad Anthony Wayne, was the commander of the forces in those area, in that area. And so some of that is in the poem. In the poem is a trip I made to Washington, D.C. for this poetry conference sponsored by this group called Split This Rock, which is a great organization of poets and working in activist ways to try to make the world a better place in a lot of different ways. And so there's some of that stuff in the poem. Walt Whitman comes in. Did y'all know when the Civil War started, Walt Whitman first thought that his poems might actually stop the war, right? About as well as all the other times. But then his brother was wounded. He went to Washington, D.C. He'd been living up in the New York area and helped nurse his brother back to health. And he stayed on there for a considerable time, visiting soldiers in the field hospitals, trying to tend to them. He was not a trained medic or anything, but his work and his life were really changed by that experience. There's also a little teaching stuff in here, some stuff. Okay, that's all I need. Now, the epigraph to this is the last line of Naomi Shinkoff-Rice's poem, Jerusalem, which goes, "It's late, but everything comes next." Somewhere near Defiance. I live near Defiance, a white name pressed on an old place. Mad Anthony Wayne's soldiers broke down the orchard when the battle was theirs. Build a fort where the Aug lays and Maumee rivers meet. Water will answer anything. The moon, the wind, the mud. The rivers mingle and move on. Once I drove my little car right into the heart of the empire, huddled with my friends to plot and complain. All over town, the poets and other malcontents were hiding in the open, vowing to split the rocks and terrify the despots. In the coffee house, we tallied our losses and wondered how to subvert the lyric eye until the hot waitress grabbed the mic to say that racism wasn't over yet. We clapped for her, then wandered toward the Capitol, launched some ragged words to each other and the wind. All right, you can have shock, we told the adversary, but awe belongs to us. Walt Whitman thought his poems might stop the war, and then did not. He moved to Washington, took a day job so he could go to the field hospitals, read to the wounded, write letters for men with no arms or eyes. I have been hurt, but am mending well. Do not weep. I will find you one day. I walked around for days, found no field hospitals, lots of monuments. I passed the suited and booted, shaggy and lame, proud and weary, and it seemed that each of us carried a wound we were trying to hide. Meanwhile, the drone pilots turn their hellfires loose from dark rooms in the suburbs, buy a six-pack on the way home. 1,200 veterans of the last good war die each day, and the stools at the VFW stand like puzzled mushrooms. That's veterans. These days, I wake up grateful that my heavy dreams are gone. I snag the zipper of my coat, pull it free, and walk off puzzling over slides and words and stratagems. Then I step into the room and see a row of faces,
hopeful and new as yellow apples hanging in the orchards of Defiance. The morning came brilliant to my quiet town, sun and junipers were rounded on the wire. Nothing that I do matters to the earth or the sky. But I've stalled around too long. It's time for declarations, time for floods, time to put down the Toledo blade and take a very long walk. Time to say peace on terror, peace on drugs, peace on defiance. Peace on Mad Anthony and his soldiers, gone so quiet now, and the warriors they fought and the fruit trees they tore. The Anglais and the Maumee join and drift on, exchanging sticks and soil and bits of news. We are in the earth already, and the earth with us. Even from defiance, nothing's more than half the world.
The past 2 nights, we've had a chance to hear from Jeff Gundy some of his thoughts on Debs tonight, some of your poetry, and I just wanted to thank you for the opportunity to hear you and to congratulate you on your those two most recent books. I'm going to take just a few minutes here, maybe 10 minutes, and ask a couple of questions, then we'll open it to
time that they find things funny. My family used to have these conversations in which my beloved wife would say, "Oh, there you all go being sarcastic again." And, my sons and I would say, "What do you mean we're sarcastic?" And she would say, "Oh, no, you're never sarcastic." And then we'd say, "Well, you can be sarcastic too. What do you mean? I'm never sarcastic." And so we'd kind of go around in that way. And it was fun for all of us, I think, although maybe less fun for Marlise than for the rest. I've always been drawn towards humor, and I've always found, I think, drawn toward those moments in poems when there's that opportunity to sort of break that bardic spell of deadly seriousness, that sometimes encounter. And I don't think that that's necessary in every poem, and I think poems can be, it's easy to ruin a poem with the wrong kind of, with a laugh at the wrong moment, and those sorts of things. But I also think that a lot of times the way that our lives work and our minds work, it's valuable and sort of healing even to laugh in the midst of our troubles and our struggles, to figure things out and to contend with our sorrows and the difficulties of the world. It's hard to sort of calculate that. When I do a reading like this, I can predict sometimes which lines people are going to laugh at, but it doesn't always work the same way. Audiences are different, and sometimes I kind of wait and nobody laughs, and then it's like, oh no, did I ruin that line? But I do think, that there's, there's light verse, there's the kind of writing that just aims to be clever and funny, and that's a genre of its own. I think that I'm certainly not alone amongst poets who have funny moments that were poems about serious things, and poems that have aimed to be serious in their ultimate objectives and so forth. And so I do admire that. I mean, one of my favorite poets is a guy named Andrew Hudgens, who is prone to putting these, especially in his younger days, put these awful jokes and filthy jokes sometimes in the middle of these serious poems about God. There's this poem called "Praying Drunk," in which is filled with these bad jokes, and is also this deeply earnest meditation about. The poem ends with something like, "I wish my soul were bigger than it is." So it's just, I think of it as a way kind of stretching the time sometimes.
No, that rings true. One of the things that always strikes me, especially hearing you read your poetry, is the way that humor sort of allows you to disarm some of the most challenging material and then take it on a step. Like, it's almost a chance to breathe and then re-engage. And so less than a maybe I'll ask you one other question before opening it up. And this is one that has struck me for some time with your writing. And that's to say that it seems to me that hearing you talk in the last couple of days and reading some of your material, that you seem to be a little surprised that after several days of years or decades, literally, of working as something of a self-conscious outsider to some of the institutions and some of the conversations that have been going on, to have suddenly found yourself very much at the center, or a figure, sort of this larger conversation.
Yeah.
I think you just gave the Mueller talk at the Gundy, and here you are at the Bechtel lectures. And I think, right away, I think about the 1998 essay, "Praise of Workers," where that sense of outsiderness is an important part of the role of the artist. I think of the new collection of essays here, from the first essay, sort of recuperates that, or talks about this a little bit. It's titled "Declining to Be in Charge." We kind of address this a little bit. But I wonder if you could reflect a little bit on this, perhaps in relation to your own role, but also in the larger conversational moment of your writing, which I think has changed a great deal over since since 1990 in the first session. What happens when those lurker of that position of an enemy starts to take that change to the group?
Yeah. I don't know. I think you have to light up for the provinces or something, as Huck Finn put it. Yeah. That's a great question. And I've been conscious for some time that even while I sort of nurtured this image of myself as this outsider, this liberal, and so on, I've had this tenured position at a Mennonite college for a long time, and I've been at all these conferences and given these various talks and done various things, and it still sort of startles me when I say things and people take them seriously, or when I encounter my words quoted by somebody else as though I actually know them, that sort of thing. It is a sort of interesting position, and I mean, one can hardly be other than grateful for recognition and so forth. I have this sense though, and I've tried to look at this in a fairly conscious way that the writing that I've done, especially the sort of prose things, but also like this new Mennonite poem, which I know you've written about and others have written about. For those of you who don't know, a long time ago I wrote this kind of tongue-in-cheek poem called How to Write the New Mennonite Poem, which I had fabricated putting these various things in, Plot-Deutsch and Marner's Mirror and Durkheim's and so forth, and talking about sex, but putting your wedding ring. It was just really kind of a spur of the moment thing, and one that I certainly did not mean as a sort of prescription. It has been since sometimes construed as serious advice about what Mennonite poets can or cannot do, especially by people who are not writers. I think that the actual poets, they don't pay any attention to that kind of stuff, or if they do, people have written poems in response to it and ignored and rebuked me thoroughly, which is fine. I mean, that's absolutely fine. But it was John Law, the historian at Goshen, who sort of took that poem as serious advice. And so the essay that you refer to, in that essay, I really try to make a case that I don't want to be in charge of it. I don't think anybody else should want to either. I think we should all do our work, and we should certainly talk to each other and argue about what we're doing and all of that. But the notion that there should be one right way to do it and everybody else should try to adhere to that, I think that's the death of creativity. I don't see any reason why we should be going down that path. And I don't think people are, really. So that's good.
Let's open it up because maybe you guys have a couple of questions at that time.
I was wondering if you could just kind of touch on your inspirations, ideas from being at home, being here with these surroundings. A lot of times you'll talk about things of peace or culture and then kind of tie back to a very specific location, usually in Western Ohio, which is great, but is that something you're intentional about? Is that something that just kind of happens while you're right in a specific area?
That's a good question. And it really has to do, I think, more than anything with my writing process, which is mostly when I get the chance to sit down wherever I am and to try to start out. And often I start out with something that's right there. And I've written, in the last book there's some, but in the earlier books there are a lot of poems written on the road somewhere too. And there was a time when I was writing a lot of those. And there was something about being in a fresh place that's often opens you up in ways that familiarity in the home place doesn't. And yet if you only write when you're someplace else, that leaves a lot of time when you don't write anything. To me that connection between sort of some kind of grounding in the where one is, it's not every poem has to have that. But often I find that the connection between those particular details some of those details and these other things that sort of enter in as I just sort of see where the poem is might move, seems fertile. And it seems like a way of operating. As often, rather, I kind of like poems that do that have two or three different things mixed up in them somehow. I know that there's for a long time, the kind of dominant American poem, at least, has been this sort of fairly narrative lyric. It starts out, the one that was sort of parodied by Donald Hall or somebody, who said, the poem starts like this: I look out the window and I become important. And then it goes on to describe whatever's outside the window, the sparrows or whatever. And then usually a dead father comes in, morning for the dead father, and then it ends with, the hawk flies away. I don't know. And there were a lot of great poems written sort of in that sort of linear mode. But I'm really interested in kind of trying to stretch that in different ways and see what's possible and what other kinds of things can happen.
You mentioned a small excerpt from the exercise that you do with your students. And I'm just wondering, how do you resuscitate poetry for students today, or are your students at Bluffton eager to write and to read poetry?
Well, yeah, every one of them just comes in and says, make a poet of me. Yes, teach me. Well, I would say that the ones who tend to take my poetry classes are pretty eager to do it. Yeah. And that, of course, is a small group amongst the larger student body. I had an interesting thing happen, though. I'm teaching this Becoming a Scholar class, which all the first-year students have to take this class. And so I have 23 freshmen just out of the whole group there, not selected at all. And I decided this year, there's a part in the book, in the course, which is just finished now, where each of the instructors get to pick a book of their choice to work through with the students. And I decided to pick Rumi. This wild Sufi poet that I mentioned last night, and just see what would happen, right? So Rumi says all these outrageous things, and way outside of the experience of all but a few of the students, right? And so I said, just don't worry about understanding this. We're just going to read these poems. We'll do a lot of reading out loud. We did a lot of that. We looked at some videos online. Watched a Sufi dance, a whirling dance. The last day we tried doing a little whirling ourselves, so that was sort of partially successful. Some of the kids had trouble not giggling all the way through it. But then I asked them all to write a poem at the end. Write a poem in response to something that we've read in Rumi. And they were all great poems. They weren't all really even that good poems necessarily, but everybody did it, and then we had this last day where we all read our poems to each other, and we applauded for everybody, no matter what, and, when I think that, and the sense I got from the group, of course, partially they want to tell me what they think I want to hear, but they all seem to feel all right about doing that, and some of the ones I wouldn't have expected to get into it at all were saying, Mom, this is fun, we should do this more often. So I think that kind of exploration in language and that kind of sort of free exploration of these big ideas, I mean, it's something that people are sort of trained away from in school a lot of the time, but it's not necessarily dead. So, I mean, I'm feeling, a little more encouraged about that. And then, of course, I mean, the other thing in a class where you're trying to teach people poetry is working at the craft, which is a whole different thing. It's great to come in wanting seminaries, and I've often had preachers in the audience when I spoke, and some of my good friends were preachers, so, you know, I think, you know, that if you've gotten in trouble a few times, you're probably doing things right. I mean, that would be my sense, and I would encourage you to, you know, continue to test the boundaries. No one's always trying to figure out what you can say that will be useful to your audience. Sometimes that involves challenging, and sometimes that involves supporting. So, yeah, thank you.
That is not such a unusual question. My stepdaughter, they're in the hospital in Greece, and she is going to be teaching in Houston, Texas, spirituality and preaching to second-year theology students. And when you told me about that faculty committee while you're writing your notes, I should never mention this. I shouldn't tell anyone, but I would. I married my husband, late in life, went over to Illinois, went to a little tiny mission church. We had a fantastic minister who was picked up, as you can imagine, later for Indianapolis. And so whom did we get? We got a young pastor from the college in Elkhart, who did not know how to preach. It was pitiful. So I would sit behind someone with my piece of paper, and as he spoke, I would rearrange his sermon so that it was organized and put the conclusion up to the thesis statement and create an organization. So the question is, who do we have to really teach pastors how to preach? We need it. And I complained to June Allman. I said, no, June. Now, I know there are courses in California that teach ministers how to preach. But do we know about that? And what do we do here in Ontario?
So I think we've got a future job for you here in
Okay. Well, we'll have to negotiate the terms. I will keep that on my agenda.
I think we're going to have to wrap it up there. Thank you once again. Before we head out, I will remind you, in the new year, we have Patrick Friesen, we have Pat Graham, we have David Bergen and Snyder coming through. And in 2 weeks' time, on Wednesday the 26th, and there's Hayes will be here, and it's a privilege to have you in a great call. So do join us then. But now, please help me thank Jeff for two nights of wonderful.
Thanks all of you for coming to this